I love VFDs, vacuum fluorescent displays. They used to be all the rage on high-end consumer electronics and even in automotive dashboards thanks to their bright colors, high contrast, and super saturated look. And that's why I built this VFD display for my PC case. For about 35 bucks in spare parts, you too can monitor your CPU speed, load, temperature, and a whole lot more. I'll show you all the steps right now in Dave's garage. Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. Now, if you're a fan of the channel, then by now you know that I have something of an LED obsession. And it turns out that what I really like are highly saturated colors with a lot of contrast, and that goes all the way back to Light Bright being among my favorite toys as a kid. Of all the display technologies, from LCD to OLED and TFT, VFD remains my favorite. The displays were much more common about 20 years ago, and they decorated the user interfaces of everything from high-end stereos to automobile dashboards. I've always wanted a VFD display for my PC, something that might show the CPU speed and temperature and so on. So when I was cruising eBay one day and came across these two-line VFDs for $25 each, I was intrigued. I'd always envisioned it fitting in a 5.25-inch drive bay, but of course nobody even has those anymore. And the units I found that had been used in cash registers, and so placing one behind the lightly smoked glass of my Leon Lee PC XL case might look great, and I wasn't disappointed. VFDs are unlike almost any other display. They're light emitting rather than being backlit or through-lit, and probably the closest modern display you'll encounter is the OLED, like this small display from Heltec. VFDs are an old-school technology, however, and they operate by having a heated wire throw off electrons. And being vacuum tubes, they have a lot in common with other vacuum tubes, like an anode and a cathode and a grid that separates them. These electrons are pulled from the cathode to the anode side, which are the actual segments that you see lighting up. They light up because they're coated in phosphor, just like an old CRT screen, and the phosphor converts those electrons to photons that you can see with your eyes. In between the wire and the light-up segments can be found a fine grid that allows the controller circuitry to selectively turn on individual segments. Those could be the 7 segments of a number or a matrix to display text with, or pretty much anything that the designer can envision. By controlling the charge of the grid, the circuit can turn off or on any single lighted element. The only thing it can't do is change the colors. You would need filters for that. And for more info on how they work, there are 2 good VFD videos that I came across, one by Technology Connections and another by Posey, and I'll put links to them both in the video description. They're both worth checking out. Now, I've had some luck with the Noritake display that I wired up to an Arduino, and the text is crisp and bright, but the display itself is just too small to use it in the way I want to use it, so I needed a larger one. And with no off-the-shelf units still being produced at anything close to affordable prices, I started looking for old salvage units out of old electronics on eBay. Let's take a quick look at the units I found. I bought a pair for $50, meaning each one was $25. I haven't found them in large quantities anywhere, but since they were used in several million cash registers over the last few decades, they should be reasonably easy to locate. The only problem is that while I knew they were VFD displays and that they featured 2 lines of 20 characters, I didn't know anything else about them. I didn't know how to control them or even power them up, and all the information I could find through the eBay's vendor info was in Ukrainian. The VFD's PCB carries the brand name of Datex, but pretty soon it became apparent that they were either the same as, or at least compatible with, a fairly common Samsung unit called the 20L20 3DA12. That in turn led me to a datasheet with some critical info. There's a connector with 4 wires that is normally used by the cash register to communicate with the VFD, but its existence is a bit of a red herring. You can supply 12 volts here, but my early attempts to then communicate with the device over RS-232 went nowhere. Checking the datasheet, it seems that there's an inverter or an inverting amplifier on the data line. I eventually realized I could just connect the signal line just after that inverter, and that would give me normal communications, and so I wired my TX upstream. Technically, I think this would be a good application of the MAX232 chip, which would also then handle the voltage translation. Because you see, the RS-232 spec actually uses signaling so that 0 can be negative 15 volts and a positive 15 volts for a 1. We'll only be sending 0 and 3.3 volts, but spoiler alert, it will still work. It might not be the right way to do it, but it works. Internally, the VFD makes use of some other higher voltages, like 24 volts and 30 volts, but it has an internal boost converter to step the 12 volts up to whatever it needs, so we only need to supply that single 12 volt supply. In fact, it will helpfully even provide us back a regulated 5 volts that we could use to power our own circuitry, like the Arduino that we're about to connect. I won't be needing that 5-volt output because I'm going to power the Arduino from the USB port, since connecting it to USB is actually the whole point. The VFD board itself is just a raw serial RS-232 connection, but besides the fact that my PC, like most modern PCs, completely lacks an RS-232 port, I also don't want to have to wire it up to a converter dongle that I cut up. Even if I did go that route, it would only give me a single serial connection to the device. That would be great, except this display isn't fully compatible with the PC monitoring software that I plan to use. That software is called Ada64, and it's a little like Hardware Monitor in that it presents a comprehensive suite of PC metrics like CPU frequency and temperature, and better yet, it has an optional feature that can drive an external display like ours. Ada64 is commercial software, and there's a 14-day evaluation period so that you can make sure it does what you want. I said it could drive a display like ours, but not our actual one, because despite supporting what looks to be more than 50 different types, the Ada64 software doesn't support the Samsung. The interface to the VFD is a simple text stream as far as putting characters onto it, but there are control codes for performing operations like clearing the screen or positioning the cursor, and none of that will work. At least it won't work until we make it work, so let's make it work. What I'm going to do is to plug a small ESP32 module into the USB port. That will give me a serial connection from the PC to this ESP32, and then the ESP32 will have one of its serial transmit pins wired to the VFD's serial input line. The ESP32 can have up to 3 hardware serial ports configured at once, but we're just going to use 2 of them. The first is that USB UART connection back to the PC, and the second is going to be configured on pins 16 and 17 as RX and TX. Since we won't be receiving anything back from the VFD, but rather just sending data straight to it, we actually only connect the TX line. That means the connection from the ESP32 to the VFD is just one signal wire plus the ground. The VFD will be configured by jumper to 9600 baud as shown in the datasheet, and then the ESP32 will act as a repeater. Anything that comes in the USB port will be immediately sent on to the serial connection linking the chip to the VFD. For simple text, that would be all we need. However, even with this relay approach up and working, we won't have full control over the display from Ada64 because it will be configured to talk to a Matrix Orbital VL class VFD. Our VFD is a Samsung, and it won't understand those control codes, so we need to do some translation along the way. We're going to want to translate the codes that Ada64 sends for things like clearing the screen into commands that our VFD understands. That means it's time to write some code, so let's jump into the Visual Studio Editor and put together our simple little relay application. We'll then upload it to the chip and see what happens. Our whole project is just a single file, main.cpp. Every Arduino project contains 2 important functions. The first is called setup, and it is called one time when the chip starts up. Then it calls a function called loop that you provide over and over and over forever, and that's where you do the bulk of any work that you plan to do. Pretty simple, at least to get started. In the setup function, you can see that we initialize 2 serial ports. The first, simply known as serial, is the connection back to the PC over the USB cable. The second, called serial 2, we create and assign pins 16 and 17 as the receive and transmit. We specify 9600 baud in both cases, 8 bits, no parity, and 1 stop bit. Next, we print ready to the VFD, preceded with the character code for clear screen, which should have the effect of getting the display ready. And indeed, if we run the project at this point, the screen clears and the display prints ready, showing that we are indeed able to communicate with the VFD from the ESP32 and from the PC, ultimately. Next, we want to add our code to our loop section that will take any serial communication that comes in the USB port and then send it on its way to the VFD. We'll add the code for the other direction as well, even though that wire won't even be connected, just for orthogonality. If there's any data available on the USB side, we read that byte in. Before we just send it on its way, however, we need to translate any important control codes. But how do we know what a control code is? Well, we can figure that out by looking at the spec for the Samsung display that we actually have on hand and the Matrix Orbital display that we're going to pretend to be. And the Matrix Orbital expects control codes to be prefaced with FE hex and then a code and some optional data. Now, I didn't want to have to support the entire control set because for all I know, most of it's unused here anyway. And so to figure out what commands Ada64 was actually making use of, I ran a serial port monitor program to snoop on the communications between the Ada64 package and the VFD. Right away, I could see packets of control data starting with the FE byte, so I knew I was on the right track. To send the cursor to home, for example, it sends FE48, and to clear the screen, it sends FE58. To set the cursor position, it sends FE47 and then 2 bytes, one for the row address and the other for the column address. To clear the screen of our actual Samsung VFD, we just have to send it a single 0C hex byte, basically an ASCII control code with no other lead bytes. And to home the cursor, it's just 0B hex. Our code then looks for the lead FE byte, and if it sees it, reads the next byte to inspect what's going on there as well. If it recognizes a screen clear, cursor home, or cursor position call, it immediately translates it into a Samsung command and sends it. The trickiest case is the cursor position. We read the two bytes out of the input stream for row and column, and then we send the special sequence 1F24, which I got from the datasheet, we send that to the VFD followed by the row and column. A simple bit of code, then, is all we need in order to have our Samsung VFD effectively pretend to be a matrix orbital unit, at least enough that the Ada64 program can use it. So to finally get it to display our PC stats, we need to connect it to Ada64 and configure the external display layout. To do that, we bring up the Ada64 preferences and we head on down to the LCD display section. We'll make sure it says two lines of 20 characters to match our physical layout, and then we'll pick matrix orbital VL. With that set, we can proceed to the LCD items page, where I've configured four pieces of information to be displayed. My CPU speed in megahertz, CPU usage in percent, GPU speed in megahertz, and finally the CPU temperature in Celsius. You can even configure multiple pages of information here. It'll step through the pages every few seconds automatically, but I'll just keep mine simple with a single page. Once we click Apply or OK, it should start updating the display automatically, and sure enough, the VFD springs to life and displays the information we requested. It updates about once a second, and the stats seem to match what I see reported in other monitors like Task Manager. With that, we now have a simple VFD display that can monitor the PC's vitals. With the ESP32 module being under $5, our total outlay is still under $30, and I think it looks great behind the glass of the case. And by the way, if you'd like to keep up to date on my daily shenanigans, follow me on Facebook at fb.com/DavePL. It's where I post stuff like this as I'm working on it, and a lot of stuff that just doesn't make it into episodes. If you have any interest in matters related to autism, Asperger's, or ASD, check out the free sample of my book on Amazon at the link in the video description. It's everything I know now about ASD that I wish I'd known long ago. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage. And by the way, random note, this is a Tommy Bahama shirt. Why do I mention it? Because I like the shirt. And if you want to get it, I guess you get it at Tommy Bahama. But what I did is I wrote to Tommy Bahama and I said, hey, I've got a marketing idea. I wear a lot of your stuff on my show and it's got like 50 million free views, so why don't you become an episode sponsor? I never heard anything from them. So, if you work at Tommy Bahama and don't want me to wear a black piece of electrical tape over your logo when I start wearing your shirts because I'm going to wear them anyway, but I figured, hey, discretion is the better part of valor. Maybe I just didn't reach the right person. So if you're the right person or know that person at Tommy Bahama, give me a shout.